Our next speaker is Tarek Loubani. He's an emergency physician working in the Gaza Strip and in Canada, and he's developing medical hardware devices. And he's going to tell us about the Palestinian use of free hardware and software. So enjoy and give a warm welcome to Tarek.
Thank you to Triple C for inviting me to give this talk and to you for being here tonight. I want to start with just some very basic information here about myself. If we could get the video feed up. Okay, so, there we go. Basically, if you want to get a hold of me, you can find this project on GitHub. You can find our team on OpenMed at Freenode, or you can always get a hold of me by email, hopefully one of the easiest emails you'll ever have to remember. And I'll bring that information up at the end. I want to start then with a story. This is another story because you've heard so many about refugees. But this story is a personal one because it is my story as a refugee and about the time that my father reminded me of who I was. He put this card in front of me when I was 8 years old. This card was literally the only thing that attested to my existence as a human being for the first 12 years of my life. It says, "The Director General affirms that Tarek Loubani is a Palestinian, and as proof, I've given him this identity card. Not allowed to work, not allowed to own, not allowed to do anything." That was it. And so I sat in front of my father. I had just gotten, I think it was a C on some meaningless subject, as an 8-year-old. Who cares? But he cared. He put that paper in front of me and he said, "Son, this paper, it doesn't prove that you're somebody, it proves that you are nobody, that you're nothing." And there we were, living in Kuwait with a nice apartment that we had rented and a car out front. And he said all of these things didn't belong to us and could be taken in a moment. He had only one caveat to this nihilism. He said, "There's only one thing you have, one thing that the wolves can never take away from you, one thing that you can never be dispossessed of, and that's what you know. That's the information in your head. That's what's up in here." And so it was that his apocalyptic warning would result in me and my family, minus my father, because he was trapped in Kuwait at the time, driving through this, the highway of death, as it would later be called, with my mother crying tears for weeks while she got us out, her 4 children, until we finally made our way through, I think it was 4 or 5 different countries, and into Canada. Mine is a microcosmic lesson of the lesson that all Palestinians are given, because all Palestinians have been dispossessed at some point, or will be. What do you think the parents of these children will tell them about who they are and what they possess? What do you think is the meaning of their homes and their physical possessions? What is it that they own or that they have? Their parents will tell them what my parents told me. You have nothing and you are nothing. Only what's in here. And so, if they are in their predator drones, then we must be the prey. And that means that we will always live in the third world a different life from the life that people live in the developed world. You have to be on one of the two sides of that predator drone, of that advanced missile, of that technology, that litigation, of that treaty. And we had seen the light of the First World from that those refugee camps. We saw it. And what we wanted was not the PlayStation 4s and the iPhones, though yes, of course, great stuff. What we wanted was the CT scanners and the hospitals that were outfitted so that you could feel like you could go in them and come out a whole human being still, just like you went in. That is the wealth that we wanted. That is the wealth that we saw, and that is the wealth that they protected, both metaphorically and literally, through all manner of instruments of neoliberalism and colonialism. They do it because to them, everything they see, everything in the world around them is fish. They can't see the world any other way. And so they think that if you catch a fish, I can't have that same fish. And they don't realize that we live in a different world where not everything is fish, where there's information. And that information can go anywhere and be anything, and it can help everybody at the same time. It's not a new concept. It's a concept that was almost perfected by Magritte 85 years ago, represented here. That is not a pipe. It is the information to make a pipe. That is not an STL, or that is not a reproduction that is an STL. Let's put some economic terms on this, because the people who we are working against, the people who promote the anti-commons, they put language on this stuff. This is the main language. We can divide it into two main axes, excludable and rivalrous. All items more or less fall into these categories. And so fish falls into this category. It is a non-excludable, largely, commodity that is rivalrous. Indeed, it is very hard to keep people from catching fish out in the harbor, but if one person catches one fish, then the next person cannot. Where society wants us to be, by and large, is right here. Products that are non-rivalrous, but excludable. Think, for example, of an MP3. An MP3 should be this. A public good, it is not excludable, you can't keep people from it, it is non-rivalrous. You give somebody an MP3, you haven't taken away an MP3 from anybody else. And yet, what is desired is for everything to be here, a club good. You need a membership. Be that the country you live in or the amount of money that you make. It is excludable because they have excluded you, not because of any innate or inherent reason. How can we turn things from club goods into public goods? Or another question, how have they turned things from public goods into club goods? Well, here are two men who've led the charge. Birch Bay and Bob Dole. They came up with this legislation that ended up basically making it so that one thing that was available, non-excludable and non-rivalrous, that is, all of the information coming out of universities and these sorts of charities and other little groups, could now be patented. Patenting is the main weapon here. That's how you turn things from usable by everybody, available to everybody, to usable by a few, and available to a few. Their policy was absolutely a success. Here you see the patents starting from 1963 all the way to 2014, total patents granted. 1980 is highlighted in blue. Everything before that is basically since the time of a man named Vannevar Bush, who kind of floated the main idea that information should kind of be out for folks. And as you can see, it's relatively stable, more or less minor deviations, more or less the same. But from 1980 to 2014, it virtually looks exponential. Let's look closer at the numbers. 1980, 66,000 patents. In 2014, 326,033. And so these weapons, they have resulted in us not being able to take things from a simple idea to something we can use, but instead we are loaded. We have to walk through these landmines. Now, this is a story that you all already know, because it doesn't matter what country you live in. I'm guessing that everybody here lives in the first world. These are issues that innovators in the first world must contend with. But by and large, these are issues that stop people in the first world from becoming rich. In the third world, these are issues that can mean the difference between life and death. Here's an example from the late 90s, early 2000s. Profiteering pharmaceutical companies versus South Africa. South Africa was in the middle of an absolutely terrible crisis, which arguably they have not exited, with HIV/AIDS. And pharmaceutical companies, using the weapon of patents, was saying, I'm sorry, we can't give you this medication at a rate that you can afford. We cannot give this medication to everybody, because what protects our profits? Now, most people aren't that crass most of the time. They're not saying what's going to protect our profits, because that's bad public relations. But they say, oh, well, what about our research and development funds, et cetera, et cetera? Of course, mostly done on the public dime. But in the end, every once in a while, we happen to see one of the type who pops up, who speaks a little bit more from the heart, as we have recently. What my father told me initially was what I've been taught for all the years of my life. What he told me is that either you are one of the predators or one of the prey. It is an absolutely irrefutable truth. It is a natural order. It is absolute. God gave us this. You have to be on one side or the other. You just have to accept it. And so if you are born the caribou, you have to own that existence and just accept it. Well, just before I got on my plane here, I was at work as a doctor. When I went to my shift, I did not go there so that I would allow the natural order to take its course. I did not wake up today so that the natural order would take its course. Fuck the natural order, and fuck the wolves who are behind it. I don't want it. The people in Palestine don't want it. My patients don't want it. None of us want it. So why do we accept it? If we look at the world around us, what we're seeing then is this thing that we want to just throw off, that natural order. But the terms of our insurgency have to be careful. You can't, as the caribou, look at the wolf and say, well, I don't really care, you know, fuck you and fuck your natural order, and I'm not participating. You have to be careful, because they're potent, they're dangerous. In this particular case, the main danger to us in the third world and developing nations is treaties. These laws are applied on us by treaty, and you can't just opt out. The Palestinian economic system is shut down by fiat. Medication can't arrive by fiat. All of these things happen because we are too weak. And so how do you respond? What is the tool of resistance? We alluded to it earlier. My father even told it to me as a child. Knowledge and the commons. That is where a better future comes from, and that is where our examples live. So let's think about the free software movements. Let's look at some examples. Some of you are German. Munich is one such example. Munich has shifted almost all of their city digital infrastructure into free and open source. They even have their own Linux distribution. It's pretty amazing, actually. There are other examples that are some minor cities here and there. There are some statewide examples, for example, such as Kerala in India. The chief minister, basically like the highest person within Kerala at the time, said, "We believe that free and open source software is an essential component in our drive to democratize information technology and bring its benefits to all sections of society." In addition to Kerala, Tamil Nadu has done something very similar also in India. And then there are some partial ministry-level efforts that have been happening. For example, Italy, in their ministry of, I think it is Defense or Interior, you know, had decided just a small move to go from Microsoft Office to LibreOffice. Apparently small moves, but really meaningful to the people around us. We look at this from places like Palestine, like the Gaza Strip where I work, and we think, why can't we do that? Why can't we participate in this commons? What is it that we can do to contribute? At the national level, there are a couple of very potent examples. The two main examples that I ran into were Ecuador and Brazil. Ecuador, if you guys were at a talk yesterday, is a very interesting and nuanced place. So there are some authoritarian tendencies. Bethany Horn, who I believe is in our audience here, I won't point her out, is one person who has been visited by the authoritarianism of the group. But notwithstanding, they are doing some very good things. And one of those very good things is free software at a national level. It's actually quite incredible. Directed from the presidency. Brazil, very similar. Brazil started their move almost at the same time, maybe a little bit before. So Palestine looks quite ripe for exactly the same thing that we've been seeing. Has a few characteristics. These are the literacy levels of a few different countries. United States and Germany, basically 1% who are illiterate. Brazil and Ecuador, 90.4, 91.6. Palestine, 95.3. That's the West Bank and the Gaza Strip. My best guess is if you were to include the diaspora, that number would go significantly up, because the diaspora tends to be well-educated. That means that this lesson that my father gave me is a lesson that clearly Palestinians have been receiving for years, if not decades. They're intelligent people, they're well-educated, they're living under occupation, and they want to see it change. So we've started all of the same things that you would expect. We've started, of course, replacing all of our servers with Apache-based, if any of them were ever on Windows. We've started, of course, using backends for our content management systems like Joomla and Drupal. Of course, we've started doing those things. In terms of the infrastructure, that's more or less the step where we are. We're at infrastructural components rather than desktops. We have a very nascent EMR that will be coming up, hopefully soon, and we expect that this EMR will leverage the best of what we have and what we see. However, there's something else that's interesting, a response to the necessities that we have in Palestine. We learned our lesson from people decorating their shoes and submerging their computers, from novenas and homemade chicken CT scanners. And what we've started doing is making our own hardware as well. I believe that the Gaza Strip is the first place that is trying a national level strategy for open source hardware and is pushing it hard. We saw 3D printers, we saw how they worked, we wanted our own, and we got them. Leftmost is the very first 3D printer ever made in Gaza. In the middle and the next one are their children, made entirely in Gaza. Some of the electronics have to come in, all of the motors are salvaged from garbage. We expect that within a year, we'll be able to make everything domestically. That's our hope, and that's our dream. And I think we can get there. Of course, my own work has been to make medical devices. That's where I've been leveraging them. This is a stethoscope, a very early version. This is the final version, as of 3 weeks ago, approved by Health Canada. This is a first world medical device that is available for pennies. $2.50 to replace a $300 stethoscope. It's not that people had $300 stethoscopes running around, it's that they had nothing. Now they have something. It's been with the help of Clement, who you'll recognize from around here, Jen, who you'll recognize from here, and some engineers who I can't really show because I fear for their safety, our Palestinians, the heroes, the real heroes of this work. And as you can see here from a frequency audio response curve, it's as good as anything out there. We're working next on a pulse oximeter with the help of a really talented engineer, Hanan Ennis, from University of Ottawa. And that should be ready by the middle of next year. Surgical tools will be forthcoming because right now in Gaza, we're washing everything with salt water. And prosthetics are coming. We hope. Lots of issues there, but not technical. We have this origin story for the commons as though the commons was something from the past that was there and then now is gone. But that origin story, I think, is a myth. And when we recognize that the commons are actually an evolution of where we are, rather than somewhere that we were before we're trying to reclaim, then I think the next step is trying to figure out how to get back there. And that's what we're trying to do in Palestine. How do we get back there? The biggest way is to break down those borders and blockades and share information. And so I want to invite you, all of you, to come with me to Gaza in May for the first international free and open source health conference, where we will discuss these ideas and where we will try to move forward the commons. If the anti-commons is generally funded by the military-industrial complex, as we see within Silicon Valley and so on, then maybe this commons can be funded by the evergreen spending that we always have in healthcare. Healthcare is one of the biggest spends in the Gaza Strip, and if we direct it in the right places, we can also use it to develop our national sovereignty. Join me in whatever way you can, and let's make it a more sovereign, better place for Gaza and for everywhere else. Thank you.
Thank you for the talk. And we have about 5 minutes for questions. So please, if you have any questions, line up in front of one of the microphones. Yeah. Please.
I would like to know how you distribute your free and open source instruments. Is this also possible for other countries that have the same problem as in Palestinian areas to get those?
Yes, absolutely. One thing we don't do is give medical devices. Anybody who's interested, and there have been a few ministry-to-ministry contacts on this, is basically encouraged to start up their own, fundamentally, fab lab. So what we do is we go into a country, talk to their engineers, engineering departments, and so on, and we try to get them up and running so that they're manufacturing their own stuff. This means anybody who's tried to start an open source project or a free and open source project will know that the more contributors, the better. You don't want consumers. You want people who are participating. And so anybody who wants to, it's under an open source license, the open hardware license. So, and actually it's also cross-licensed to GPL v3. Please take it. It would be my privilege to see it in use everywhere else. It really would be. Everybody who's working on it wants to see that.
Okay, so thank you very much again. And see you at the next talk. Enjoy the rest of the conference. Oh, wait, we have a question from the internet, it seems.
What will be the solution to the Palestine?
I don't think you need to worry about the occupation. I think that's the question. Don't worry about the occupation. The occupation is a little bit like a marathon. You have to keep working. You see, we see the end, though. The Palestinians will take care of their own freedom. You don't need to worry about that one. All you need to do, as much as possible, is try to not participate within the occupation. Now, I travel through Israel, and nobody who travels through Israel is allowed to endorse the boycott, divestment, and sanctions campaign, because that would be illegal and would mean I could not travel through Israel. However, some people consider it to be a nonviolent way of participating against the occupation. Now, what we do need to do is figure out what happens the day after occupation. That's what worries me. For example, there's a Coca-Cola bottling company being built in the Gaza Strip. Why? It's going to use more water than the entire Gaza Strip has available to it, more concrete than in all of the reconstruction project. Why? Because they're looking for the day after occupation. And what I don't want is for Palestine to turn into South Africa. Beautiful dreams, excellent vision, and you lose the war the day after the occupation ends. That's why we have to encourage these democratic institutions. That's why we have to participate in these, I guess, essentially like chaos-based, anarchist-based collectives that are going to move forward the democratic process there and everywhere else.
So we have time for one final question. The microphone on the right, please.
The big one. Can you say something about the interface between open medical devices and regulation? So in Europe, most of the stuff is public, or a lot of it is public, so you have two layers of regulation. One is what devices you are authorized to use and operating on a human body. The other one is how are you authorized to buy the stuff. So procurement regulation is very, very rigid in some European countries in terms of medical device, and most of the stuff would be illegal,
It was very important for us. The project wasn't, people have made stethoscopes, and actually a lot of people told me this. They said, yours isn't the first 3D printed stethoscope. I made one, we made one, whatever it is. And it's true, we're not nearly the first 3D printed stethoscope. We're the first validated and now Health Canada approved 3D printed stethoscope. And so I think that these regulations are actually a good thing, because the population is an incredibly vulnerable population on the other side. We see lots of experiments being run on poor and disenfranchised people. It happens in the first world, think Tuskegee, and similar things are happening today. It happens in the third world, you know, think Nestle and such projects. So I think the regulations are a good thing. The FDA, you know, probably not. It's very expensive, very hard to get through. But it's not taxing to get through reasonable regulatory bodies like Health Canada. So I myself don't object. And what I see within the Gaza Strip is people there want to know that they're not receiving garbage. So they're asking for these regulatory approvals. The Gaza Strip will not use expired medical devices that people, you know, well-wishers in some hospital in the first world have decided, oh, well, I'd rather throw this away in the Gaza Strip than throw this away in the garbage. No, we don't want that. There's a dignity as well that has to be provided, and that dignity comes with the same standards being met in the third world as in the first.
Okay, thank you very much. Unfortunately, we're out of time, but I hope you enjoy the rest of the Congress and see you at the next talk.